to power them. It's basically supposed to have a lot more efficient movement, because the central pitch here, where the energy sits between the vehicle and such, so low and low. So when we just pipeline through this different execution unit and the retirement stage, will take care that everything is reordered again after the execution. Head right back, will then commit the results to the machine state. So this is something called the superscalar architecture. This is ordering different execution units in parallel to each other. And this is going to be, you see immediately that you potentially gain factors in performance by doing that, just by adding execution points. And if you have a lot of loading points, execution, you could potentially add like many loads. And that's not always 10 plus 1 performance. So if you double them, you get twice the performance.
Sure. You
need to
have
an order to have a superscalar. Yeah, so you don't have to have it. You don't need to be on order to have a superscalar. For example, light is essentially superscalar. But if you order, so it has a very delicate scheme of dispatching this. But it is more insightful in this way, I think. But you don't have to have a slot condition. Okay, so the last thing is the last generally used technique that we're considering now in a block diagram is semi execution. We thought that we had all this big number of execution units we could probably put into the CPU. However, we might need to deal with even more data, even more floating point instructions that we actually have to execute. And in order to improve the situation, I mean, even more is more text points. However, we can just introduce an element-wise computation of a vector. It's not a real vector, it's just a bit of memory, of local memory that's called a register, that holds a number of different elements, for example, of array, including these rows. And we can add them all one by one. This execution is pretty efficient, because we know all of them are efficient. We can implement it in a very efficient manner. We don't have to actually expect dependencies between them. And this is something that most of the floating point comes from nowadays. These vectors have grown from 64 bits to 128 bits for a very long time. Now just the sandwich have grown to 256 bits. And the doubling of the performance of the sandwich, basically, the peak performance of sandwich, basically, is how it is, the fact that we double the vector. We nowadays have four double precision values at the same time. All right, this is what I just spoke about. And now let's look back at the sandwich. This is the same diagram. Now the question can be identified. What we just talked about. What is the legal part? I mean, you see something up here. Here's pretty good. Here's legal. Something there was the instruction fetch, right? So there's an instruction fetch, there's an instruction point, you can put down here, like just tracks. This instruction executing, here's the legal. So here come the instructions coming here, they come from the level one instruction fetch. So we're telling you there's something called a micro cache, which we've got later. And again, this is something, allocate, relay, and retire. In this case, the retirement unit has been put here. Because when you allocate a name, meaning you're assigning registers to the execution. I told you that in terms of essentially to the outside, there's a number of local storage areas called registers. There are 16 of them. Then you can use to store a single 64-bit integer directly on the chip, directly very close, one cycle distance from the execution. However, internally, we have a lot more of those. And if one of them is missing, so you can't dispatch it into the execution because it depends on another.